Welcome to the Heartland Running Podcast. Join Crystal, Andy, and Chandler as they explore all things running related in the Heartland and beyond.
Hello there, everyone, and welcome back to another edition of the Heartland Running Podcast. One thing that's really good about the Facebook page that we have is that we really get a good feel of the type of people who listen to the podcast, type of activities they have. I would say the majority of us are strictly runners. There's a big part of us that do adventure racing. Also, a little bit of the obstacle course racing too, which is just a little bit less than that. And so, you know, there's a handful of us out there that's in the group and of the listeners that do a little bit of triathlon. And I know that everyone at some point thinks, you know, maybe I'd like to try that. But me personally, I feel like the triathlon is just a little bit of a little bit intimidating and something that I have really considered doing. I just don't know how to do it. And so really the theme of this episode here is we're going to have a triathlon 101, what it takes to get into triathlon, what it takes to make that transition, talk a little bit about, you know, how you do your training. Running's pretty easy because you just run, but triathlon, you've got three different things that you have to worry about and you have to consider with, and we're going to get into that today. And I really am excited to talk to Brett Daniels, and he's going to give us a little bit of help on that and a little bit of education here. So Brett Daniels, he has competed in over 100 triathlons, and these are all ranging in distances from the sprint all the way to the Ironman. And hopefully we can get a little bit of information on what those distances mean. Also, including the 2008 Ironman 70.3 World Championships. So he's been coaching since 2004 and holds expert level certification from USA Triathlon and USA Cycling. So I would definitely like to welcome Brett to the show. But first of all, I almost forgot. We've got to introduce ourselves. I'm Andy.
I'm Chandler.
And I'm Crystal.
Okay, so we got that out of the way. But if you've been listening to this podcast, I'm pretty sure you guys know who we are. So anyway, I would like to welcome Brett to the show. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
All right. Well, right off the bat, just so that way we can get a little bit of introduction to yourself, you know, how did you and when did you originally get into triathlons?
Well, interestingly enough, I also came to triathlon from a running background. And I actually can't even say that I was a true runner for that long before getting into triathlon. I grew up playing ball sports, you know, football, baseball, basketball. And I didn't really start running until I joined the Army, where they didn't really give me much of a choice. And after I figured out that, hey, I'm actually kind of good at this running stuff, it just kind of naturally evolved into, okay, I'm running, let's see what else is out there, and I moved over into triathlon.
So what was it, something that you'd ran for a while and you were just wanting just to mix things up or do something different?
Yeah, I get bored really easily. So it was one of those things where I was starting to get a little bored with running and was looking for a new challenge, just something different, you know, a way to mix it up. And, you know, we've all seen the Hawaii Ironman on TV. And I remember watching that and thinking, wow, that's crazy. I would never be able to do something like that. But, you know, I'd sure like to give it a try.
Well, there's terminology that goes into whether you're running, whether you're doing triathlon. And always one of the things that maybe annoys runners a little bit is whenever there's a non-runner and they ask you, well, how far is your marathon? And we all know in the running world that we have these specific distances and specific races that, you know, actually mean something to a person that doesn't run or is just having conversation with you. In their mind, a marathon could be a 5K or could be a 10K or something like that. And so it's the same thing with with triathlon, and that's something that kind of confuses me a little bit about what the different distances are and what they mean. I've heard of Olympic distance. I've heard of sprint distance. Obviously, the Ironman, which I believe is a branded distance. But could you take a second just to go through all of the distances and what they're called and what they mean, kind of starting with the shorter ones going on up to the longer ones?
Absolutely. And that, before we get started on your intro there reminded me of a little anecdote. I had someone ask me one time about my telethon over the weekend. And I was I went and hung out with Jerry Lewis this weekend. You know, we had a great telethon. So,
well, I hope plenty of people called in.
Yeah,
absolutely. Donated money.
You know what? I think I'm going to do that. I'm going to come back and say, hey, I did a telethon over the weekend.
Yeah. So that's always funny when people ask. Yeah, the same thing, you know, because I still do run quite a bit. And you get that all the time. Oh yeah, you know, how far was your marathon this weekend or whatnot? And you're like, well, marathon's 26.2 miles. So, but yeah, so the sprint distance is kind of the, I don't know, I guess you'd say kind of the outlier, because it's standard for international competition. So if you go to the sprint distance, world championships or national championships, it's going to be a 750 meter swim, a 20K bike, and a 5K run. Now, if you go to the local sprint that your town may host or, you know, somewhere else, you could get anywhere from a 300 yard swim to a 800 yard swim, depending on what they decide, you know, to put in there. The bike can be anywhere from 10 miles to 17 or 18 miles, even up to 20 miles. And then the run is usually 5K. That's usually the constant with all sprint triathlons, is you end up with a 5K run. So the sprint distance is kind of a hodgepodge of different distances, especially for the swim and the bike. The Olympic distance came about when the triathlon became part of the Olympics in 2000. And it's a standardized distance that tries to be fair in all three disciplines. And some of the other distances, you get proportionally where the swim's a lot smaller. So if you're a good swimmer, it kind of takes away some of your advantage. But in the Olympic distance, it's a standard 1.5K swim, 1500 meters, a 40K bike, and a 10K run. And the difference between that amateur athletes do and that the pros and the Olympians do is the pros and the Olympians have what's called draft legal racing. And that's where on their bikes they ride in a pack and they can draft off of each other. Whereas in amateur racing, although draft legal is starting to make its way into amateur racing, for the most part, amateur racing is non-draft legal, which means that you can't sit behind someone else on your bike and have them break the wind for you, which is a huge advantage. The next distance is the 70.3 or half Ironman distance. 70.3 is an Ironman branded trademark. They came up with that a few years ago because they thought that half Ironman didn't give justice to, I guess, the gravity of the distance of the race. And a half Ironman is exactly that. It's half of an Ironman distance. It's a 1.2 mile swim, 56 miles on the bike, and then a 13.1 mile half marathon at the end. And then the Ironman distance, or the iron distance, is a 2.4 mile swim, 112 on the bike, and then a full marathon at the end.
Okay, I'm exhausted just thinking about it, but it's so cool. I have a question. So when you moved from the running world into triathlons, and I know you'd worked your way up to Ironmans, what distance had you run? Like, had you done a full marathon before jumping into the triathlon world? At what point did you make that transition over?
I had not, actually. The longest run I'd ever done prior to getting in a triathlon was a half marathon. You know, the full marathon distance was something that I always wanted to do, but the races never fell at the right time during the year to make the training work. So I hadn't done a full marathon yet. And I actually started, you know, doing sprint triathlons. My very first triathlon was actually when I was deployed, in Kuwait in, 1998, I believe. And it was a reverse triathlon. Normally triathlons are swim, bike, run. And there's a reason for that, because if the swim was last, we would all drown. But this particular race happened to be run, bike, swim. And luckily the swim was in a pool that was about 4 feet deep, because I kept having to stand up during the swim because I was cramping and was exhausted. But yeah, the sprint distance is where I started. I didn't do my first full marathon until, I believe it was 2003. So it was prior to doing my first full Ironman, but it was not prior to doing my first triathlon.
Wow. So as a runner who's looking to transition in, how does someone choose a race and what distance to start at? I mean, if somebody's already doing marathons and ultras, does it make sense to jump ahead right into like a 70.3 or something like that? Or should, you know, we start smaller?
No, it's a great question. And it really depends on the athlete. I mean, normally I would say start with a sprint distance, just simply because it's the shortest distance. It allows you to kind of get your feet wet, both literally and figuratively. And, you know, you can kind of figure out if you even like this sport before making the investment, you know, to move up to longer distance races. You know, if there's an athlete out there who has been running marathons and maybe swam growing up and has a real comfort level in the water, there's no reason that they, you know, they couldn't start at the 70.3 or even the iron distance, which I totally wouldn't recommend. But there are people who do it. The biggest limiter, and it's not just for runners, for anyone who's getting in a triathlon from another sport or just is new to the sport, is the swim. Yeah, unless you grew up, you know, swimming on the swim team, whether it was the neighborhood swim team or, you know, a club swim team or whatnot, most people just don't have the comfort level in the water to jump into anything longer than a sprint triathlon. I mean, I grew up, you know, I went to the Y and took swim lessons and was comfortable in the water as far as like, you know, water skiing in the lake or, you know, playing in the pool or whatnot, but I didn't have proper swim technique. And I didn't really learn proper swim technique until I started doing triathlon when I was, you know, in my late 20s. So that really seems to be the limiter for most athletes, is the fact that swimming is such a technical sport and you really have to be comfortable in the water to do one of the longer distance races.
One of the things that is intimidating for me as someone who's considering looking into trying the triathlon, here's just a couple of thoughts that I have is that, you know, I feel like I can do decent at the swim. I'm not trained at swimming, but I'm a strong swimmer. The biking, I feel comfortable with that. I've done plenty of biking in my life. It's whenever you roll all of these transitions together as someone who's never done it before, you know, what are some of the things that can give a newcomer confidence going into this that I'm going to do it right? I'm not going to go into a transition area and make a fool out of myself, knock everyone's bikes over and look like a complete idiot. That's one of my biggest concerns there. What are some things that someone wanting to get into it can educate themselves so that way they have the confidence to be able to transition between these three disciplines?
Sure. Well, I mean, the old adage, practice makes perfect. You don't want to do anything on race day that you haven't practiced in training. And, you know, to be completely self-serving, I could say get a coach, you know, because the coach is going to make sure that you're prepared for your first race, you know, and make sure that you aren't going to see anything on race day that you haven't already practiced in training. One of the things that I do with my athletes, whether they're brand new or whether they've been doing triathlon for, you know, 10 years or whatever, is we practice our transitions in training. And the week before the race, especially when we're tapering, so we're not doing as much, you know, swim, bike, run volume, I'll have them go out and do, you know, a 30-minute workout where they do bike to run transitions, and they'll do, you know, like a 5-minute bike and then come in and transition and go do a 1-minute run or a 2-minute run and then come back and hop back on their bike and do a 5-minute bike and then do a transition and do a 2-minute run, just to make sure that that's a fluid process. You can gain a lot of time in transition if you do it correctly. You can also lose a lot of time in transition if you do it incorrectly. So it's definitely something you want to practice before race day.
One thing that I think that would be helpful, and this is just my own personal opinion, is to find a triathlon and volunteer.
And to
observe. And so now if someone were to volunteer and observe and you go to that race director or go to someone in charge, where do you think the most important place for you to request to be stationed to where would that place be to where you would get the most advantage of observing and learning how the entire process works?
Probably in transition, because you see the athletes coming in from swim exit. You'll see how they, you know, they come in and take their goggles and caps off. And, you know, most of us who have been doing it for a while, you know, we race in either tri suits or a tri top and bottom. You know, we don't change in transition. So it's a matter of just, you know, pulling off your cap and goggles and going to your bike and starting that process and then exiting, going to bike exit and then coming back with, you know, bike in. And transitioning from bike to run and then run exit. So the transition area, if that happens to be something that I guess that seems to be something that maybe that you have some questions about, then absolutely, you know, for other folks, it may be, you know, if they have bike questions or if they want to see what the swim looks like, you know, an open water swim and a pool swim are completely different. So observing an open water swim prior to doing a triathlon would not be a bad idea at all, because there's a lot of kicking and elbowing and dunking and goggles being ripped off. And it's not on purpose. Well, some of it might be, but most of it's not on purpose. It's just, we're not fish, you know, we're not designed to swim in a school and not bump into each other.
You know, and triathlon has one of the best volunteer terms as well. So I don't know a whole lot of triathlon terms, but I know one of the positions that you can volunteer for is stripper.
You know, they should put that on like the advertising, because I think that'd get a lot more attention.
That's right. Come out of the water, get a stripper. That's the one term I know. And so that's it, and correct me if I'm wrong, it's the volunteer who actually helps people out of their wetsuit.
That is correct. Yes. And strippers are great when you're doing a wetsuit swim, because it helps you get out of your wetsuit quicker. But yeah, that's kind of a loaded term when you go to volunteer for a race.
Well, and I think that's also the quote. Yeah,
I've heard the term stripper for triathlon, and I'm trying to get my mind wrapped around what you're actually talking about. I'm struggling.
If the water's below a certain, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was just saying, if the water's below a certain temperature, you're allowed to wear a wetsuit. And getting out of that wetsuit after you come out of the swim is a challenge. It's neoprene. It's going to stick to your skin. You know, getting in and out of your wetsuit is, you know, it can be a challenge if you don't practice it. And a lot of the bigger races, especially the Ironman branded events, normally have these. They have what are called wetsuit strippers. And what you do is when you get out of the water, unzip your wetsuit and peel it down to your waist. And then once you get to the strippers, you lay down on the ground and they'll grab your wetsuit and they'll literally strip it off of your body. And so you just grab your wetsuit and you run into transition and get going on your bike. It saves a lot of time, because if you're sitting there trying to fight with your wetsuit at the transition rack, you know, if it gets hung up on something, or if you haven't practiced and it gets bunched around your ankles or something, it can cost you time.
Okay, so that's the most difficult transition, is going from water to bike. It seems to me like bike to run seems pretty simple compared to that.
You know, I would say actually the opposite. Swim to bike transition is, unless a wetsuit's involved. Now, if a wetsuit's involved, that kind of equals them out. But if you're doing a non-wetsuit swim, I mean, literally coming out of the water is as easy as just taking your cap and goggles off. And if you've practiced in your wetsuit, that's not an issue either. Like I said, you just roll it down to your waist. And then if there's strippers, you know, you let them rip the bottom part off. And if there's not, then you just go into transition. And there are techniques that are easier to explain visually rather than, you know, with words. But it's easy to get out of your wetsuit. For bike, you've got to come in, you've got to get out of your shoes. You know, you've got to come in to transition. Trying to run in bike shoes is difficult, because it's like running on ice skates. So you want to get out of your shoes before you get into transition. And then you've got to run through transition, find your rack, which isn't always the easiest thing to do if it's a large transition area, or maybe if you haven't paid attention to where your rack was. Because if you misrack your bike, that's a penalty. So you've got to put it back in the same place where you took it from. And then sometimes getting your shoes on sweaty feet is difficult. So that can sometimes take time as well. So to me, I would agree with you. Probably the swim to bike, actually putting the bike equipment on and getting out is a challenge. And then getting the bike equipment off when you come in to transition to run is a challenge.
Now, the three disciplines, the one that does intimidate me the most, and I think it's probably going to be pretty common among other people that are interested in trying triathlon, is the swim aspect of it. Do you think that it would be a benefit for someone to maybe start out with something like a duathlon and then eventually transition into the swim? Or do you think you should just jump in with both feet and just go right straight into a triathlon?
It's really either or. If you're somebody who really has a lot of anxiety about the swim, and that may not even be something that you know that you have until you try one, then absolutely, doing duathlon and just getting into the multi-sport world and kind of learning about, the different terms and, the equipment and stuff like that. Absolutely. The problem is, and I don't know what it's like around where you guys live. Duathlons around here are few and far between. They're really hard to find, just simply because most people, if they get into the multi-sport world, are doing triathlon. They're doing swim bike run instead of run bike run. So, if you can find one, if your local, sprint race has a duathlon option, then maybe the first year do the duathlon and see how you like it. And then you can work on your swim, for the following year and jump into the triathlon world. But the swim, the swim is an issue for a lot of people, just because it's kind of unnatural. And, I had a friend of mine, he had a saying, he said, you can walk on the run, you can coast on the bike, but the bottom of the lake's a really bad place to rest on the swim. So, and that's essentially what it comes down to. I mean, honestly, if you're on the bike and you're tired, you can coast, or you can even stop and step off your bike for a second and catch your breath and let your heart rate get down. Same thing on the run. If you're running and, your breathing's labored and your heart rate's through the roof and it's 100 degrees, you can stop and walk and let all that stuff come down. If you're in the middle of the swim and you're at the furthest point on the swim, in the swim course, and you get a cramp, or, you're tired or whatever, that's kind of a difficult situation to be in, especially if there's not a kayak or some other water safety personnel around you that you can hold on to their kayak or their paddleboard till you catch your breath and keep going. So that definitely seems to be the limiter for most people who are making the transition into triathlon.
Okay. Well, I've got one more question on our intermediate triathlon 101 course that we're taking here. And then after that, okay. I want to get more specific into all of the disciplines and be a little bit more specific about them. But I've had a friend of mine that he recently transitioned into a triathlon, and he kind of came up with a saying of, once you go try, your free time goes by. And I don't know if he's actually accurate about that, or whether, he's doing his training correctly, but we all know what it takes and what time we put into the distances that we run, whether it be 5K, 10K, half marathon, marathon, we know what that time commitment is. I would be really interested, without getting into a tremendous amount of detail, because I know that training is complicated, but let's say, for instance, someone does train for half marathons or marathons, looking to transition, what does that time commitment in training look like as compared to just strictly running? Are you going to be spending a lot more time because you're adding two more disciplines to that training, or are you splitting things up to where it's not that much more of a time commitment?
It's a great question. And a lot of that depends on what the athlete's goals are. If you're someone who wants to go out there and, finish the race, then that's going to dictate, obviously, a lower training, you know, a lower amount of training hours, a smaller training load, because it's not going to take
I would say that the majority of our listeners are middle-aged, middle-pack. We've got some very talented athletes that listen to this, but they are more age groupers. I don't think that we have anyone out there that, or very few out there that are actually looking to compete for podiums in the top spot. So I think we're all middle pack and people trying to age group place.
Okay. So again, you know, it comes back to, you know, what your goals are, and ultimately with any training, whether it be running or triathlon or, you know, adventure racing or whatever you happen to be doing, it comes down to your available hours. You know, if you only have 6 hours a week to train, then you only have 6 hours a week to train. You know, it's not one of those things where you can create more time, you know, out of thin air. But just assuming that someone has unlimited time to train or a large amount of time to train, the training load is, you know, commensurate with the distance. You know, if you're training for Ironman, that's probably a pretty accurate saying about your free time going bye-bye, because it's like having a part-time job. My age group athletes that are, you know, that want to do well and want to feel good the whole day and do their best at the race, they're hitting 18 to 20 hours a week of training in their peak weeks. And even leading into their peak weeks, you know, they're at 13, 14, 15 hours of training. That's a heavy training load, and more than I would say, unless you're an elite marathoner, that even marathon, you know, athletes are putting in on the running side. You know, for shorter distances, obviously the training load will be less because you're not going as far. Although, you know, a lot of the top Olympic distance folks are training just as much as the iron distance folks. They're just doing different kinds of training. You know, they're training at higher substrates. They're training multiple times a day, you know, stuff like that. So again, it kind of depends on the athlete. You know, if you come to me and you say, hey, you know, I'm doing Ironman, whatever, and I want to do the very best I can do, and, you know, maybe that might put me on the podium, or maybe that might, you know, put me in contention for a spot for Kona, then yeah, we're going to train, you know, we're going to hit 18, 20 hours a week during our peak weeks, just because you've got to put in that amount of volume to be ready to race 140.6 miles. Now, if you come to me and you say, hey, I signed up for Ironman, you know, fill in the blank, and, you know, it's my first one and it's a bucket list thing for me, and I just want to finish and enjoy my day, then, you know, 12 to maybe 15 hours tops for the peak weeks, because you're out there, you're going to be going at a much slower pace. It's all going to be easy, you know, and it's just going to be, you're out there having fun on race day. So it's not going to be one of those things where you're trying to race. You're out there participating, for lack of a better term.
Now, you just said it's all going to be easy, right?
Yeah. I mean, most athletes are not going to get, I don't know how familiar you guys are with heart rate zones, or if you guys train with heart rate zones for running. But if you're familiar with heart rate zones, your whole day for Ironman is going to be zone two and below.
Yeah.
You just are not going to get out of that aerobic substrate, just because once you get into a point where you're burning more carbs than you are fat, your day is going to come to a halt pretty quick, because you're going to run out of fuel.
So it's our heart rate zone that's easy. It doesn't mean the day's easy.
Exactly. It's a long day.
Yes.
Yeah. No, it's a long day. There's nothing easy about being on your feet for that many hours, but it's, I guess, low intensity would be a better descriptor than easy.
It's technically easy.
Yeah, there you go. and you can't see Chandler's doing air quotes for it.
So do you spend equal time on all three sports, or are there some that you prioritize a little bit more?
Absolutely. You prioritize sports. You know, The basis for our discussion today has been kind of coming from running to triathlon. So if you've got somebody who has a strong running base, you know, somebody who's been running for years, multiple marathons or half marathons, or just, you know, they run a lot, we're not going to run as much during triathlon because that's a strength already. We want to work on bringing the bike and the run, or the bike and the swim rather, up to the same level as the run. And so, you know, just depending on the athlete, it's, I hate to keep saying that, but it really is athlete specific on how we attack each training plan. But, you know, if you come to me and you're not a strong swimmer and that's, you know, that's really a weakness, we may swim 4 or 5 times a week. We may be on the bike 3 or 4 times a week, and we may only run twice a week, just depending on the hours you have available for training, just because those two disciplines lag so far behind the running that we've got to get them up to the same level. You know, in theory, if you have the perfect athlete, I guess you could say, that's equal in all three disciplines across the board, then of course you would split your training time equally between all three disciplines. But I haven't found that athlete yet. So we have people who bike more, we have people who swim more, we have people who run more. And that's why the cookie cutter plans, you know, the general plan you find on the internet, or, you know, that you get out of a magazine or whatever, if you follow it, are you going to finish? Probably. Are you going to do as well as you could have? Well, no, because that plan's not tailored to you. And, you know, something that might be your weakness, you may not be working enough. And something that's already a strength, you may be working too much.
Before we go too far into the individual disciplines, which we want to do, how can people find you? So if they are looking to, you know, find a coach, what's the easiest way to get in touch with you?
You can visit our website. Our coaching company's name is Orbital Endurance, and you can visit us at orbitalendurance.com, or you can email me directly at brett.daniels@orbitalendurance.com.
Great. And we'll make sure to put all that in the show notes as well, so people can find the links easy for that.
Okay. Great.
So that completes Triathlon 101. I hope everyone's been taking notes. There will be a test at the end of the show. And so now we're going to kind of dig into to the 4 different disciplines of triathlon: the swim, the bike, the run, and then the transition area. And so who would like to take swim?
So I got a question regarding swim. What I'm wondering is, what's the biggest beginner mistake you see in swimming? You know, is it usually just bad form? Is it bad transition? Is it just flailing around rapidly and slapping everyone in the face? What is something you continually see beginners in the triathlon just messing up?
Well, you hit the nail on the head there, and it's really kind of all three of those. The biggest mistake that I see, the first one is overestimating their swim ability. We used to put on a triathlon here for a company that I was associated with, and it was a 500 meter swim in a cove in a lake. And so I was injured a couple years ago, and so instead of racing, I was helping out volunteering, and my job was to be on the beach with a walkie-talkie to look out and see if I saw anybody having problems. And we fished probably 7 or 8 people out of the swim that day, and, you know, talked to them to make sure they were okay, but also just out of curiosity kind of said, hey, you know, how much swim training did you do? Did you do any open water practice before you came out here or whatever? And probably 5 of them didn't train at all for the swim because they were like, oh, it's only 500 meters. I can make it 500 meters. Well, no, you can't, because we pulled you out of the water. So that's the biggest thing that I see, is people who overestimate their swimming ability, and they don't put enough time or effort into the actual swim training. The second thing, though, would be the fact that most people who didn't grow up swimming don't have good technique. And, you know, from running, you guys know, if you run with poor technique, what are you doing? You're not as efficient, and you're exposing yourself to injury because your body is not moving in a biomechanical pattern that it was designed to move in. So the biggest advice that I can give somebody coming in for the swim is, spend the money and take some swim lessons. Find somebody local to you, because they need to be there on the deck with you, and take some swim lessons. And it's going to take more than 1 or 2, and really learn proper freestyle technique. And then once you learn proper freestyle technique, get in the water and drill and drill and drill and drill until those muscle, that muscle memory, those muscle patterns are second nature, and then start adding yardage on top of that. What that's going to do is it's going to give you more confidence in the water. It's going to make you more efficient in the swim, so you're not burning up all of your energy. One of the things that runners coming to triathlon will find is, wow, you know, I got to the run and normally I'm a, you know, 25 minute 5K-er and it took me 33 minutes. Well, it's because you're exhausted because you used all your energy in the swim and the bike and you weren't able to run like you're capable of. So those are the biggest errors that I see people make in the swim. And then, you know, the third one is just train the swim more than you think that you need to until you're comfortable. Do some open water swims to get used to swimming into water that you can't see your hand. You don't have a black line to follow. And there's so much that goes into the swim. And that's the thing that people really tend to underestimate when they get into triathlon.
So I have a question too. Even the pool's kind of intimidating for somebody who's just starting off too. So maybe you've done some of the lessons and stuff. Can you give just a really quick pool, like the lane etiquette?
Absolutely. The best case scenario is to find a pool where you don't have to share lanes. That's not always possible though. So yeah, pool etiquette. If you're in a group, you know, if you choose to join a master's group or if you're doing a swim lessons group or some sort of swim program to where you're all in the lane, you're all doing the same workout, then you can do what's called circle swimming. And that's where you swim down the right side of the lane to the other wall and then you swim back on the right side of the lane. Coming back, you're always on the right side of the lane. So you're swimming in a circle. And if you're all doing the same workout, that works out great. If you're in a lane with someone who's doing a different workout and you're sharing a lane, a lot of times splitting the lane on either side of the black line, as long as it's a standard width lane, works the best because, you know, if you're doing 50s where you're practicing your technique, you're going to be going slow. I mean, you should always do your drill slow because you're emphasizing the technique. Whereas they may be doing 100 on their best average time, which means they're going really fast. Well, those two things aren't going to mix doing circle swimming. So that's where you'd want to split the lane. Like I said, though, ideally, maybe try to figure out a time or a place to where you can go swim to where you have your own lane or you swim with a group to where you're all doing the same workout. But that's kind of the lane etiquette. If you're going to get into a lane with someone, ask them if you can share their lane and wait till they're done with their set. And, you know, when they're done with their set and they hit the wall, just say, hey, do you mind if I share with you? We can split, we can circle, you know, and just be polite in that regard. Don't just jump in and start swimming because the worst thing in the world is when you're, you know, coming down the lane to the wall and you run head on to someone that you don't even know, didn't even know was in your lane. So that's really kind of the basics.
Great. And then, so we think of swimming as kind of simple, but there's always the one thing about triathlon when I looked into it before is like gear and more gear. What for the, and we're just still focusing on the swim. What do we need to have? And what's maybe some of the nice to haves?
Okay. Well, at a minimum, you need goggles. And that's really all you have to have. I mean, you don't want to swim without goggles, either in the pool or in the lake or the ocean or the river or wherever your race happens to be. It just, obviously you can't see, you need to be able to see. So goggles are a minimum and there are a myriad of different brands and different sizes. My advice is try to find goggles that fit your face. Our faces are all different and the goggles that fit me well may or may not fit you well, just like shoes. So you want to choose, and it may take you several pairs before you figure out which ones you like and how they fit your face. So that's at a minimum. As far as like swim training goes, what I like for my athletes to have are fins, because I like for them to wear their fins when they do drills, because it keeps your hips up, keeps your hips from sinking, so they can concentrate on the drill at hand and they're not furiously kicking, trying not to drown during the drill. Another thing is a pool buoy and paddles. I generally don't like using paddles with a brand new swimmer just simply because their technique is not where it needs to be. And if you use paddles with incorrect technique, it puts a lot of pressure on the shoulders. So the paddles are normally for later on, but you can do pull sets with a pull buoy without the paddles. And again, that just helps your hips to stay up to where they don't sink. You know, you can get a snorkel. Snorkels are actually legal in triathlon to use during races. Very few people use them because if you get water in it, obviously if you've ever snorkeled before, you know, that generally doesn't end well. But you can get a snorkel to do, pull training with, just to work on, you know, your body position and stuff in the pool and not having to worry about breathing. I'm trying to think of what else, what all the other little toys I have. you can get a tempo trainer, and again, that's more of kind of an advanced toy. It goes on your clips to your goggles. And you can set it for a certain tempo. It's essentially a metronome that works underwater. And if you're working on increasing your arm turnover, just like if you're, you know, if you're running with a metronome, trying to increase your cadence, it's the same concept. A swim cap for ladies. That's kind of a have to have for ladies, especially if you have long hair, and men too. If you happen to have long hair, I have really short hair, so I generally don't swim in a cap except in races. But caps, I mean, you'll get them at races and you can reuse them or you can buy them for a couple bucks at the swim store. They're not terribly expensive.
Now the snorkel, I love that because I had no idea that that was something legal because I've never seen it whenever I've watched anything on TV about triathlon or anything like that. But I like the idea of whenever you're training and you're just trying to learn how to, you know, get that good proper swim motion. I mean, it seems to me like it would be hard for a beginner to, I've got to think about, you know, the right thing I'm doing with my feet. I've got to think about the right thing I'm doing with my arms. If you can take that breathing aspect out of it and turning your head and taking those breaths at the proper time, it's just one less thing to take out of there that you can concentrate on other things, learn those things first, and then move on and add another discipline. So that's a really, really good takeaway.
Yeah, absolutely. And generally, when I teach a swim lesson or when I'm teaching a newer athlete, we try to incorporate the breathing from the very beginning, just simply because it's part of the stroke in the sense of when you roll your body from side to side, you should naturally be breathing as you roll. But again, yeah, the snorkel is a great thing to use, you know, when you're just working on maybe a different hand position or working on your catch and pull, which is a phase of the swim stroke where you don't have to worry about the breathing. So it's a tool just like anything else. It's very useful to use when you're working on technique for sure.
Great. Okay. Who wants to take on bike?
I've got another one for the bike actually. Bike is like probably one of the most expensive parts about the triathlon. I know they've got those special like aero bikes or whatever fancy name they have. And obviously, if you're just wanting to try a triathlon, it may not be the best idea to go out and buy a super expensive bike. But I'm also figuring it's probably not a good idea to go to Walmart and buy a $65 bike for, you know, a triathlon. What is a bike setup you would recommend for someone who just wants to see if they're even interested in the triathlon?
Great question. And you're absolutely right. The bike is the biggest investment that any triathlete makes. My first triathlon, I did on a borrowed mountain bike. So that's one thing that I would recommend. If you have a friend, you know, who has a bike that's about your size, or, you know, if you have an old mountain bike or something and you're doing a sprint, try the mountain bike and see if you like it before you go out and plunk down, you know, thousands of dollars on a tri-specific bike or on a road bike. That's generally what I advise people to do if they don't have a bike already, if they don't already have a mountain bike or a road bike of some type. You know, it's the biggest investment you're going to make. So borrow a bike, from a friend for your first one and try it out and see how you like it for sure.
Okay. So it seems to me like there's three different kind of transitions there on achieving that most expensive piece of equipment for triathlon. There's just like what you mentioned there, either use what you have or borrow from a friend. Probably that next step between that and the actual purchasing a new bike is purchasing a used bike. Where's the best places to go to search for those to make sure you're going to get a quality bike? And one that's going to work for you or not something that's going to be a piece of junk?
Yeah, good question. locally, if you go through a tri club, if you guys have tri clubs locally, that's generally the best place to find used bikes. You know, here in Atlanta, we've got a huge triathlon community, so bikes are always turning over. And actually, if you guys don't mind, I have a friend of mine who's one of our sponsors that I'd like to plug because he does online bike stuff. And his name's Curtis Henry, and he has a shop called Cannon Cyclery in Atlanta, and they actually have an online consignment where they take bikes in and they go over them and make sure that everything's good to go with them, and then they put them up on their website and you can buy them from anywhere. So if anybody's looking for a bike in a specific size or whatnot, they can look on his website and see what he has to offer. But there's always bikes turning over. Your local tri club, your local bike store, more and more bike stores, especially as bikes are getting more and more expensive, are taking in trades, or they will consign, they will do consignment sales like Curtis does. That's a great way to find a good quality bike at less than, you know, less than new. It's just like buying a car. You know, if you can buy a good quality used car, you're going to get more value out of that than plunking down the money on a brand new bike. But if you've ever bought a brand new car before, you know that there's nothing like having a brand new car. So it's kind of the same feeling with a bike.
Cool. So when I started, because of a running injury, I think this is how a lot of people get into this too, that I started cycling and dust off my road bike and learned how to do, you know, get clipped in and got past all that. But I have to admit, I was really overwhelmed with how technical biking is. You know, running, you throw on your shoes, you go out the door. Yeah, there's some, you know, form techniques, but it's pretty simple. For somebody who maybe doesn't have a coach or anything like that, so between understanding like gears and technique and even just how important bike maintenance is, what are some good resources that people can look for?
Yeah, you can read. There's a ton of stuff online. And even, you know, if anybody reads paper books anymore, there are a lot of great books out there to read for stuff like that. I would just advise reading a lot on cycling and cycling techniques. There's great blogs out there. There's a lot of good articles out there on it. You know, as with anything else, everybody's got a different opinion on things. You know, there's some coaches who believe in, you know, the high cadence, easy gear. There's some coaches who believe in the low cadence, you know, harder gears. You know, there's a lot of stuff out there. So my advice is just to read. And that really goes for anything. You know, the more you read and the more you educate yourself on anything, the better chance of success you have, just because you've taken into account different viewpoints and different opinions. So, but yeah, that's, you're talking about clipping in. So one of the things that I do with my athletes when they're brand new and they're clipping in for the first time is we practice on the trainer, a stationary trainer, that you can get. And that's one of the tools that I definitely advise everybody get, if you get into cycling, is a stationary trainer, because, you know, you can train inside when the weather's bad. It's great to do intervals on. It's great to do specific technique work on and stuff. But one of the things we do is we practice clipping in and out on the trainer until we get comfortable with it. And then we move to a parking lot. You know, you go into a parking lot, practice in there before you get out on the road. But inevitably, you're gonna get to a stop sign. You're not going to get unclipped in time, and you're going to fall over. It happens to everybody.
And it happens in like what feels slow motion. I was so proud when I first started clipping in. I did great. And I'm like, oh, this is so good. And then, yeah, same thing. It was at a stop sign. And I knew it was happening. And it just went. And it's like in total slow motion that you fall over.
I've never even thought of that happening, being clipped in and then falling over.
Oh, you haven't? Oh,
yeah. Low speed tip overs happen all the time. Yeah.
Yeah. It's you look really cool. Don't worry.
As your feet are connected to the bike.
And then you look around to see who saw it.
If it makes you feel any better, I would say if it makes you feel any better, I've been doing this for the better part of the last 20 years, and I will still do it sometimes. If you get an old cleat that kind of hangs in your pedal and you can't get it out, you'll fall over. It happens to everybody. It's not it's a rite of passage for cycling.
You know, I think it's just like running. At some point, you're going to fall, and when you get out on the trails, you're going to take some good headers. So it's all fun.
All right, so you've got your bike. You're working with it. You've practiced it. You've fallen over a few times. So what sort of maintenance do you need to do to take care of your bike properly, such as daily, weekly, monthly?
Sure. So let me back up for a second. When you're choosing a bike, just like with shoes, make sure that you get a bike that's fitted to you, that's the proper size for you. Bikes come in all different sizes, and different manufacturers have different frame geometries. And there may be some manufacturers that fit you and your body type. You know, if you're somebody who has long legs and a short torso, then, you know, one manufacturer may fit you better than if you have short legs and a long torso. I mean, you may be the same height as someone, but your bodies are different. So before I get into the maintenance thing, I just want to clarify, make sure that when you do purchase a bike, you get a bike that is the correct size for you, because there's nothing worse than, you know, we see it down here when Curtis will have somebody wheel a bike in that they bought offline or they bought from somebody, and, you know, it's too small for them or it's too big for them. You know, you just, it's not one of those things that it's easy to, you know, to quote unquote, make it fit, so to speak. So, that's a big deal when you get to purchasing a bike, is to make sure that you have the correct bike size. So as far as maintenance goes, in theory, you should lube your chain before you go ride every time. You should pump your tires up to the correct pressure before you go ride every time. When you get back from your bike, you should wash your bike with a hose. You know, it's super simple to clean it and wipe it down and then re-lube it and hang it up in your garage or in your basement or where you happen to keep it. And then periodically, I usually do mine right before the race season starts. Go in and get your bike tuned up. You want to get your shifter cables and your brake cables replaced if they need to be replaced. Your chain and your rear cassette will wear, so you'll want those replaced at the same time so that they wear at the same rate. And those, you know, those are done by your, I mean, you can learn to do them yourself, but those are generally things that I have, you know, my bike shop do. And then, you know, usually at the end of the season, depending on how much you've ridden and what your plans are for your, you know, if you're going to buy a new bike or whatnot, I usually get my bike just completely overhauled, stripped down to the frame, cleaned, everything relubed, everything repacked, and then put back together and ready to go for the next year. But that's kind of a yearly maintenance thing. I would say the tune-ups, you probably want to go in every couple months, get your bike tuned up. I usually take mine in right before every big race that I do to make sure that everything's shifting correctly and, you know, that my chain is not worn and stuff like that. And then your daily maintenance is your chain, but make sure your chain's lubed and make sure your tires are pumped. And, you know, your tires themselves, you'll notice when those start to wear, you can change those out yourself. Those are pretty easy to do.
Okay, two questions that I have on tires. The first one is how long or how many miles do you get out of a good quality set of tires on your bike?
Good question. And that really depends on the tire itself. There are some tires that are obviously rated, and just like car tires, I mean, you can buy a set of cheaper tires, you may only get, you know, 20 or 40,000 miles out of, whereas if you buy, you know, Michelins or something high end, you might get, you know, 60 or 70,000 miles out of them. Same thing for bike tires. I generally change my tires out yearly, whether they need it or not. That's also dictated by, you know, if you go out and you run over something and you cut a tire, you're going to have to replace it. So as far as like a set mile count, you know, maybe 3,000 miles on your tires, but tires are not so cost prohibitive that you can't change them, you know, relatively frequently, just depending on where and what you want to do with them.
Okay. And then just kind of a frivolous question. What happens if you have a tire crap out of you on a race? Are you just done for the day?
Well, it depends. You know, if you're running, so there's two types of wheels. There are what are called clinchers, where you have an actual tube inside of the tire that's next to the rim. And if you have a flat on one of those and you just change out the tube and inflate the tube with a CO2 cartridge that you carry with you and you go on your way. If you actually cut the tire down, that's kind of a different story. And I mean, some people will carry a tire repair kit where they can actually glue a patch over the over where the tire has blown out, or you can put a dollar bill in there to line the tire until you get back to transition or wherever you happen to be going. That's an old trick that you can do. Or for tubulars. Now, tubulars are actually tires that glue to the rims, and those are a little bit more, I won't say difficult, they're just different, because that's not something that most people ride anymore, and they don't ride them on a daily basis. And that's where you actually have to peel the entire tire off and put another pre-glued tire on the rim and inflate it. For me, if I'm racing shorter distances like sprint or Olympic, I generally don't carry spares with me, because if I have a flat, then I'm never going to catch up to the people that I'm racing against, and my day's kind of done anyway. So yeah, in that regard, yes, you would be done. But on longer races like 70.3 and Ironman, for sure carry spares with you, because there's a pretty good chance you're probably going, I won't say there's a good chance, because knock on wood, I've only had one flat in all the years that I've raced. But if you do, you've invested too much time and money into that race to have it end on something as frivolous as a flat tire.
Great. One of the questions I have, and I don't know if there is an answer to this or not, but as the distances start getting longer and longer on the bike, is there any way to, any hacks or any suggestions on how to get more comfortable? Or is it just one of those things that you build up tolerance to being on the bike seat that long?
Yeah, that's kind of a two-part question, and it's both. The first thing is, and this is another thing that kind of goes back to when you're buying your bike, is getting a bike fit. Find somebody local, reputable, who does bike fits, and have them correctly fit you on your bike. Because if you're not correctly fit on your bike, the pressure points where you are sitting on the seat and how your arms are reaching out, if you have aero bars or if your hands are reaching out to ride on the hoods on a road bike, are going to be wrong. And what that does is that puts pressure on your shoulders. It puts pressure on your sit bones and your soft tissue areas, you know, where you're sitting. And it's just generally uncomfortable. So the first thing I'm going to say is get a fit. The second thing is try a bunch of different saddles until you find one that works for you. And after you do that, yeah, it's just a matter of building up tolerance, because even the most comfortable saddle after 100 miles is going to start to hurt. So it's kind of a three-pronged attack. But if you have a good fit and you have a good quality saddle, then the third is going to be easier to do.
Build up those buns of steel.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. And make sure you've got a good pair of shorts too. Whether you choose to race in bike shorts or you choose to race, in just a tri short, the chamois, which is the soft area in the back and the bottom of the shorts, in the tri shorts, is going to be thinner, because if it was as thick as a bike short, you'd feel like you were running in a diaper. It's it's not a fun feeling. But for bike shorts, they're thicker because they're not designed, obviously, for you to get off the bike and run in those. In that case, you would want to change, into run shorts in transition. And for the longer races, they have changing tents, so you're not just changing out in front of everybody. So that's a personal choice. The longer you ride and the more tolerance you build up, you can ride longer and try shorts, and it's not an issue.
Okay, well, that kind of covers the bike aspect of it. We're just going to be real quick on the run, because since this is a running podcast, and most of us are pretty adept at doing that, we just have one question, and this is one I've thought about very frequently, was after a swim and then after a real long bike ride, I'm afraid that, my legs are going to be really trashed at that point. And then all of a sudden, now you have the running aspect of it. What is that transition like to step into the running part whenever you're already tired, you're already trashed? What's that going to be like? And what advice do you have for someone?
Sure. That's a great question. And one of the things as a runner coming to triathlon is, at least at first, don't expect to run the same times off the bike that you've been running on open races. So if you're, like I said earlier, I use the example, if you're a 25-minute 5K-er, we'll say, and you come off the bike at your first sprint race thinking you're going to run a 25-minute 5K, that's probably not going to happen. You know, you're probably going to be 27, 28, 30 minutes, because everything that you do leading up to the run takes away energy from your run. So, you know, if you are a brand new swimmer, you're going to be inefficient. So you're burning through energy there at a faster rate. You know, if you're on the bike, you're burning through energy there at a, you know, at a pretty good clip. And then you've got to get off the bike and you've got to try to run, you know, fast off the bike. And obviously the longer the distances get, the more significant that becomes. And then, you know, when you get into longer distances, your nutrition plays into that. You know, how are you feeling on the, you know, on the bike? How are you hydrating on the bike leading up to the run? So the biggest piece of advice I would give is don't expect to run anywhere close to your open times off the bike at first. Now, that being said, the more proficient you get at the swim, the less energy you're going to burn. The better you get on the bike, the less energy you're going to burn. And then if you're doing longer distances, you know, as long as you're taking in proper amounts of calories and proper amounts of hydration on the bike, then you should be able to get off and run. Still probably not exactly your open times, but, you know, within maybe 5 to 10% of your open times coming off the bike.
I listen to that and I keep thinking like ultra mentality, ultra marathon mentality, to where you need to be as efficient as possible at the beginning of the race. So that way you still have a little bit left in the tank and your body's still functioning properly at the end. So that's what I read out of that.
You're absolutely correct. Yeah. The way I try to depict it to my athletes is, imagine that you have, you know, a fuel tank, just like in your car. And so if you get in your car and you stomp on the gas and you go as fast as you can go, what happens to that gas gauge? It goes down, and it goes down really, really quickly. But if you get in your car and you go at a, you know, a moderate speed, a moderate pace, and you're at the most efficient level of your car working, that gas gauge goes down at a slower rate. So you have more at the end. You can go a longer distance on that tank of gas. It's the same exact concept for triathlon. If you're inefficient in the swim and you're redlining your heart rate in the swim just to stay afloat, then obviously you're burning through energy. You know, you're burning through that gas tank. You know, on the bike, if you haven't been cycling enough and you're redlining your heart rate, you know, just to get up the hills or just to do whatever on the bike, you know, you're smoking through even more energy, which leaves less energy for the run. So yeah, one of my biggest things that I preach is you got to be a good swimmer in order to be a good runner in triathlon.
Okay. Well, we've kind of gotten really long because, I mean, this conversation has been so wonderful, so interesting, and I just wanted to keep it going. But we've got one last thing to talk about, and that's the transitions. And we've discussed a lot of that previously in the episode. But I think that if we can kind of nail down just a few of the biggest mistakes that beginners do whenever they're going into transition, just that way we can kind of get a little better understanding of what it takes to go through that, maybe build up a little bit of confidence in whenever we're training and practicing that, so that way whenever that transitions into the actual race, we're comfortable.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I'll be quick on this. The biggest thing about triathlon transition is to have a routine. If you have a routine, whatever that routine happens to be, whatever order you decide to go in that order, practice that order until there aren't any hitches in your sequence, and you're going to be fast. I mean, the biggest thing is get in and get out. Don't linger in transition. Don't sit down and eat a sandwich. You know, don't, you know, don't take your time on anything. Get in and get out, because it's an area of the race where if you're efficient at it and you have your sequence nailed down, you can actually gain time on people, and it has nothing to do with fitness.
Great.
Okay. All right. Does anyone else have any other questions?
No, you know what? I don't have another question, but I just have a comment that I think I'm mad at Brett because, because I thought I had this whole triathlon thing out of my system and I wasn't going to try it. Now he's been making me all excited and making me want to do it again. So,
she will be suing you for damages.
Yeah, it's a great sport. And just because you do triathlons doesn't mean you can't still be a runner, because I still consider myself a runner primarily. So, you know, you can be a runner and be a triathlete. But if anybody has any questions, or if there's something that we didn't cover, or if there's something that, you know, one of the listeners wants me to expand on, they can feel free to email me. I'm happy to respond.
Okay. Yeah. Let's hear that email address.
Yeah. It's Brett.Daniels. It's Brett. Daniels, Daniels, at orbitalendurance.com.
Okay. And then give us your website one more time.
It's orbitalendurance.com.
Okay. Is there anywhere else we can find, like Facebook, Twitter?
Yeah. You can find me personally on Instagram and on Twitter my Instagram is at BrettD58. And my Twitter is at bdaniels58. And then on Facebook, we have our Orbital Endurance coaching page that you can like and follow. And we put up all kinds of good little training tips. And eventually, we're going to have some videos up there of drills for swimming and transitions and stuff like that. So,
That would be awesome to see. Yeah. So anyway, Brett, thank you so much for taking all the time. This is absolutely fascinating. I'm sure that all of our listeners are really going to enjoy this, because you are a wealth of information, tons of stuff, and it just good stuff. I'm excited. Crystal's excited. Now we're going to sign up for a triathlon. And
we're taking Chandler with us.
Yeah, and Chandler's coming too.
Yeah, I appreciate you guys having me. Thank you.
Okay. Well, sounds great. Well, as always, we would like to do a shout out to the Ozark Mountain Daredevils for allowing us to use their fun music for our intro and outro. Make sure that you visit www.heartlandrunning.com for the show notes and also past episodes. Lots of fun stuff going on there. Also, don't forget to join our Facebook group. As always, we like to mention that, because that's where all the fun happens. And if you ever have a question or ever want to show off something cool you've done, medals or whatever, that's the place to do it. And you'll get a lot of people really excited about it to share our enjoyment. You can also call or text our voicemail at 513-486-4636. And we'll put you on the show if we like what you have to say. Make sure you tell a friend. And if you think about it, go to wherever you pick up your podcasts and give us a review. We sure enjoy having those. And that helps other people find the podcast. So we're going to wrap things up. I'm Andy.
I'm Chandler.
And I'm Crystal.
And we will see you next time.